It's a direct, I think, product of our liberation. A lot of Kwaito tests the rights that we have, or the freedom that we have, or freedom of expression.
Yeah, for me, it just happened like more as a reflex action without like a plan that this is. I think it was a matter of saying that, fuck, we're tired of these, you know, political things. We're tired of like whatever. Now we're free. So let's express ourselves and have a good time.
Like having a bash, that would be a 6-to-6 bash, starting from 6 in the evening to 6 in the morning. We would walk freely, we would sing about what we want to sing about freely without having to feel that somebody might come and say, hey, I'll shoot you if you sing about stuff like this, you know. So we were just free.
If you weren't white, you couldn't do any of those things. You couldn't have a label, you couldn't have your own clothing range, you couldn't start your own media company, you couldn't own your media.
To us, freedom meant you are free. You can go out and take a wee anywhere you like. Take a shit anywhere you like, you know? Just like go there and do your shit. Now you are in your land, it's your land. Hey man, we went out full force. Kick the dust, man. Sure, and kick the dust, man.
With the kind of music we are sort of making, we love talking what we term township language. So talking our language, the township way, there's something which is called kwai, meaning it like it hot, it fly, it's happening, it's in. If I say, hey, sir, you're kwai, I mean, you're really happening, you're really hot.
I wouldn't say it's just kwela or maskandi or bakana or anything. It's just a whole lot more different things, but one would say disco music, you know. I think Chico and Brenda comes from disco music. Kwaito is a revamped kind of disco. You don't come around to see me in the week. You don't have a chance
to call me on the phone.
When I grew up, Bakanga, which was the music of the youth at the time, was denigrated by the so-called establishment as music of drunkards and prostitutes. People always looked down on anything new from the townships, you know, or from our rural areas. And when I lived in Botswana, there was Brenda and Chico and Blondie and Chaklas and all those groups, and they said those groups were bubblegum, but I loved it.
You know, the critics called it bubblegum, which is some word that you won't really like, you know what I mean?
Why were they saying it was bad?
Bubblegum meaning it's something that repeats some one thing all the time, you know, like you say nyachola, 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 one way. And it really bought many people that I know. You guys got no lyrics, you know what I mean? Saturday, Sunday, Saturday, Sunday, Jabulani. Saturday, Sunday, Jabulani. You know, like, As a singer, I'm not a good singer. I cannot sing opera. I cannot sing, you know. I said, hey, man, what is it that I can do to make my people hear what's in me? You know what I mean? Why can't I just combine the rap? Mind you, there was no rap those days, eh? But I started this rap kind of thing, you know, like if I can, you know, dance and talk in a way. I did a number called Fukuza.
Yeah, these words just stay stuck in my head. I remember them to a T. The lot of MCs out in the land, but none who's better than me, huh? CT. All right, y'all. I rock the party extraordinary. It's the beat that makes you wanna freak. One night off, 7 days a week. I say, feel the beat, the funky beat. Come on, CT, get them on your feet, huh?
Hey, I remember one traffic cop stopping me. He saw me on TV. He stopped me. One side. Says, hey man, what's happening? Hey man, I think I've seen you somewhere. I've seen you on TV. Aren't you the guy that's trying to sing and you talk? I said, yeah, that's me. He said, hey man, why don't you find yourself a job then? And quit this thing, man, because whatever's happening there, it was terrible.
Baby, get down to the beat, huh? Baby, get down to the beat, to the beat. Don't some fun for Goza.
I'm telling you, after 2 weeks or so, the same traffic cop, he stops me, says, hey, you know what? Hey, funny, my child likes that. Loves that song. I said, ah, what do you mean? He said, hey, man, ready. Hey, they're ready, diggy. I think you must get me a copy.
Coming to, damn, listen to this. This is amazing. It is more like, Jesus, like, what shit is this? Okay, because it was naturally competing against hip hop, and also it didn't have, at that stage, we didn't think that it had a lot to say, and the productions weren't really that hot. You know, I mean, you can listen to the stuff now, and you can even, yeah, the productions were very thin. And it was just basically slowed down house music.
Kwaito, some of its elements come from house. Actually, it comes from compilation. What happens is that early 90s, you know, we used to do compilations. I used to do compilation, get a house track, and then from there we reprogram it, and then also, I mean, we make sure that the tempo, because normally you find the tempo, the beats per minute, they used to be 120. Maybe we just bring it down the beats per minute, you know, by, it becomes, say, 115, 110, you know, so that, because people here, they were more on a, you know, on a slow tape.
Mama Wami. Mama Wami. Sure. Mama Wami.
Mama Wami.
There is no party that plays without house music. In fact, house music is the only international music in South Africa that competes with Kwaito. Every other type of music can't compete. Hip hop can't, R&B can't, rock can't, definitely can't compete with Kwaito. So it's like, yo, it's really surprising that in Europe people actually think that house is like white people's music. Cause,
but you know, when I first listened to house, I think it's also because, you know, when white kids are dancing to house, they like, you know, white kids go wild.
Yeah,
and,
they go.
But then if you listen to house and you listen to the drum patterning, as a black person you can like move to it, you know. I think it's because white people move to the tweeters and we move to the bass. So forget the tweeters,
no, they just
move
can't
to the
dance.
Bass.
I
No, check this, how I go like this, check. Yamachola pumentilo ngweni ndine ngxaka ngxaka zomziwa tiawo awo andine ngxaka ngxaka zomziwa yamachola pumentilo ngweni ndine ngxaka ngxaka zomziwa tiawo awo andine ngxaka ngxaka zomziwa
saka ndati sekuri bavaka nditi dondom tomnyere vaitoziva kuti ndine musikanzwa
vaiziva.
Yeah. Bongo Muffin, live and direct. We love it.
That means we're bad and bad all the way.
We also want to be part of our culture, so that's what we want to do in our dance music. Incorporate cultural tribal music with dance music, and that's how we think, you know, the international world would recognize us. Because we don't want to be taking quite, I mean, house as it is and take it to London and hope that it's gonna work. It's their music, they do it better. So why not do what I do better? Fuse it in with a bit of tribal or cultural music, Zulu music, Soto music, but in a dance beat, you know? That's what Kwaito is all about.
No matter who you are, I don't care whether you've moved to the States or whatever, there'll always be that little part of you. Like they say, you can take a black person out the ghetto, but you can't take the ghetto out of the black person. It's one of those things, you check.
Panzula is a ghetto-proud male person who dresses clean, who dresses in a typical ghetto style. Panzulas believe in money. They believe in spreading ghetto love. But if you touch one of them, you touch all of them. There's bound to be a fight.
Come out as dancers.
Yes.
When we dance, the dust come up, you know.
And when we're dancing like in Panzulas, we come on with stars like.
You see?
Yeah.
Panzula was also the chalk stripe suit and the two-tone shoe way back in the days. And Panzula has come back now. And now Panzula is more like wearing a Dickies with your all-stars and your white t-shirt, right? And maybe your silver chain. And maybe driving a BMW if you can. But then again, you know that wherever there's a social life, there's bound to be a fight. So also Panzula people way back in the days were associated with a lot of death because, you know, they had weapons. They were not guns and they were not the machine guns as you'd see in the Al Capone movies, but they were more like knives and, you know, and any other sharp thing that you could stab a person with and kill them.
Yeah.
State Theatre?
We're launching the...
Okay, it sounds like something very special.
Not to say maybe it's all like ni balay of Ganja, no, nice. It's all like Ikaslam, then Kulele corner. And I thinking I enjoyable and like I get come to Avanisha Nessor, young and young blind. Like it is good to move as well, like no more moon to like more solar improvement, we must move to another place, Marunga court and I'll put my court. Sure.
When Mandela came out of prison, how old were you?
I'm trying to be not. I think I was not born yet. No, Mandela, which year did he come out from jail?
1990.
Yeah, I was already born.
Sure. Tell me this this apartheid thing. You grew up after this thing, no?
Yeah.
More or less, you know. Do you think that it's still here and it's still affecting you?
Like I don't think there's a separation. Not everything is right. I think they told me we are learning about history in my school. Then those like blacks and whites, you know, they were not like now. Everything is right. Whites can come to Soweto wear and do all the things that they want. No, yeah, I think now everything's it's fine.
The one thing that we all were unified in this country, us who were against apartheid, all fought together, okay? And we beat it. We beat, but we didn't beat economic apartheid because that's unbeatable. Because you can beat the army, you can beat the government, but you can't beat the bank.
I mean, we used to do our own distribution, right? I mean, when record companies couldn't sign the music, I mean, they didn't understand what the music was all about. When we took our demos in there, when we took the first Boom Shaka, they rejected the whole thing. So we said, oh, fuck you. Why can't we do the things ourselves? So, I mean, we used to go to the taxi ranks, you know what I'm saying? You know, put off our cars doing distributions here. But at the moment, and then, I mean, that's when the record exploded. You know, I mean, you go to your record shop, you give them and say, okay, if you sell those 10, I'll come and collect my money. If you don't, okay, bring them back. So what happened is that we're here in Johannesburg, we're putting our records. So they were competing with their records, and they were finding our stuff going, you know. But then we couldn't reach a bigger market. While this record now started exploding in other areas, everyone was looking for it. But now we didn't have resources to put in. That's when we went into EMI. We signed a distribution. They were distributing our stuff.
For a young kid to grow up, you need the support of the matured people who have been there. And the truth is the major labels have been there forever. They know what is going down. They have the whole infrastructure of the music industry. For the indies, they couldn't start something and press and distribute themselves. So they need the big sister to help distribute the music for them.
One must understand that the recording industry, the power structure in the industry today is the power structure that was working things under apartheid. The same white people running the same white businesses.
It has changed drastically. I mean, a good example is a young black South African sitting here being an MD of a major record company. I must say I'm the first first black South African to be an MD of a major, but that telling you that things are slowly changing and for the better.
I wouldn't say they have changed a lot. It's to me it's still the same, you know what I mean? It's they wait for you to see what deal you want, and if you don't know, they give you their deal. And if you make it, they tell you about your percentage that you signed, and man, you signed that percentage, and it's making nothing for you, you know? But what I'm happy is that the rightists, you know, I mean, the young generation, the ones that sell from the boot are quite clever now. So when they go out there, they really make money out of them, they milk them. But in return, they get milk as well. So it's one way or another, you know, it's still the same.
The white establishment that is invisible in this country is not about it to relinquish its power. If anything else, if you look at the statistics in this country, white profits have doubled since we became free, because while we were concerned about, like, the joys of freedom, they were entrenching themselves, making sure that they don't lose their businesses. And it's never gonna change. Apartheid took away a lot of our self-esteem. South Africans, black, white, blue, yellow, are very ashamed of who they are, because you know, apartheid separated every group from the other group, you know, and manipulated conflict. So people were afraid to show who they really are. And at the same time, we're broadcasted and fed overseas culture, which consumed us, because if you're not practicing your culture, anything that is there that is more than, you know, that is more visible or more audible than your culture is going to consume you. One of the great things about Mbaqanga, or whether it's Pantsula, whether it's Bubblegum, or whether it's Kwaito, the one thing that it does is that it describes us outside of, like, most of the overseas influence that we have. And that to me is more important than anything. And when people, like, criticize Kwaito, I just said, well, I don't know what to criticize, because it's the only fucking thing that we have that is about us, you know, right now.
When the students in the 70s picked up stones and shovels and started throwing them at armored vehicles, you know, and the South African National Defense Force then fired back at them and killed them, the older people thought the youth was crazy, but they were thirsty for freedom, right? And they fought with stones and garbage can lids, and they liberated the country. And it's the very same generation that is now looking at us in an odd way, because they are now our parents, because we were born somewhere in the early 80s and late 70s by the same people who were fighting the struggle. But when we are trying to fight our own struggle of trying to find our own identity, they're fighting for freedom, we're fighting for identity.
One day, I will come there where I want to be. I will come there where I want to be. I will be in this city. I'm not going to do it. 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 I'm not going to